Good morning, everyone. Just saw the video by Pasatikas. Something went wrong toward the end, but you kind of get the gist of it. He's talking about the dividing walls that we build. It's a good message. He started out saying that good fences make good neighbors. Good fences could be just another way of saying healthy boundaries, But he also talked about the walls of hostility. They are built between
this
people.
This meeting is being recorded.
I have a question. Is there a place for healthy boundaries?
Yes.
And so, then what is the difference? Just, anyone can answer. What is the difference between a hostile wall and a healthy boundary? Just whatever comes to mind.
A healthy boundary is one that nurtures and is good. The fruit is productive. Mm-hmm. It helps. It doesn't hurt.
Correct. But a wall just shuts you out. It shuts out. When you put up a wall, it shuts. The purpose is to shut out. And as she knows, as Kiki was saying, we do actually need healthy boundaries. As Pastor Tika said, good fences make good neighbors. And what that really means, I looked up what that really means, and it means that good neighbors respect one another's property. For example, a good farmer, he will maintain his fence in order to keep his livestock from wandering onto the neighbor's farm. I remember back in the day, the slick guys in church, they would try to convince some of the ladies that the reason that it's okay to kiss them was because of 2 Corinthians 13:12 that says, greet one another with a holy kiss. The girls would say, back up, brother. John 13:11 says, just as far you may come and no further. So, as humans, we need healthy boundaries. They're essential for healthy relationships. And some examples of personal boundaries is, you don't allow people to take their anger out on you.
Right.
You don't allow them to insult you in public or at any time. Not to make negative comments about your looks or your weight. To not abuse you. To not tell off-color jokes. We even have boundaries that define who we are. I am a follower of Christ, so I will not do this and I will do this. When we have good, healthy boundaries, we are stronger, we are resilient, and we are confident, and it enables us to be stronger to help others. But the problem that we have in our world, and in our fallen world, is that sometimes out of necessity, we put up these hostile walls. In most cases, that does happen when people violate our boundaries. So we throw up these walls to prevent them from hurting us. And sometimes it's needed to protect ourselves. But other times we overreact. We overreact to the slightest thing. And we build up walls of hostility that keeps others out emotionally, physically, and on a personal level. I think we've all experienced that. We've all experienced hostile walls at some point. I remember years ago, I had a friend who all of a sudden just stopped talking to me. She just built this wall between us, and every time I saw her, I got the silent treatment, I got shunned, ignored, and I had no idea what I'd done. And so finally, I confronted her, and I said, what's the problem? And she said, well, so-and-so saved you, said you. I didn't say anything like that. So finally, I was able to convince her that that wasn't true, and, we were able to, build back our relationship and restore the relationship. But hostile walls can sometimes come as a result of misinformation, misunderstanding, distrust, untruths. But it's not just personal walls that we build, that we put up. Pastor Tikas was talking about, he mentioned the Berlin Wall in his short message. And there's a picture of this is a real picture of the Berlin Wall. But the Berlin Wall is symbolic of the Cold War. The Cold War lasted from 1961 to 1989, and that was just a representation of the hostility between the East Bloc countries and the Western world. You know, there are also walls of hostility between families, countries, people groups, blacks, whites. There are even walls between Christians, charismatic versus evangelicals, Protestants against Catholics.
Yeah.
You see, the walls remind us that there is something wrong in our world. There's something in our relationships that are wrong. Our heart. There's something wrong in the heart of people. But there's good news. There's good news. The good news is that it tells us about how Jesus, the wall breaker, broke down the walls of hostility between God and between two people groups, the Jews and all other nations. And that's this is found in Ephesians 2, 11 through 18. And can you read it from there, please? I hope everyone can hear me.
The sound is coming through very nicely.
Okay, good.
Miriam, you can hear, right? Okay. She's on mute, but she said yes.
It says, Ephesians 2, verses 11 through 18. Therefore, remember that formerly you who were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Relationship with God so that others may seek him.
And that we also can find that in Leviticus 20, 22 to 26. But we know that ancient Israel didn't really live up to that. They didn't live up to being that great example because they didn't really obey God. And by the time that Jesus came on the scene, the law had become like a dividing wall between Jews and Gentiles. And rather than helping other nations to seek God, they kind of looked down on the other nations, and they called them, you know, Gentile nations who were without the law, uncircumcised. You know, remember, circumcision was a big deal, if you were, if you weren't. And so that created that wall. And actually, during the temple, in the temple during the days of Jesus, there was a literal 5-foot wall, a 5-foot stone wall, which separated the Gentile court from the temple enclosure itself. And the wall was called the Sarek in Hebrew. And it had 13 openings in it to allow the Jews only to enter through the Gentile court into the other 4 courts. And so no Gentile was permitted to pass this dividing wall. And on the wall, there were no entry signs, and it was posted in 3 different languages. And, you know, one of these signs in stone, it can be found in a museum in Turkey today. But it reads that no foreigner is allowed past this point on the penalty of death. So if they passed that dividing wall, they could be killed. You know, the Romans gave them the authority to kill anyone passing that wall. And so that's a bit of background. So the passage in Ephesians 2, 11 through 18, the Apostle Paul is now writing to the Gentile who have come to Christianity, who have come to Christ, and he's telling them that they once were called the uncircumcision, and they were separated from Christ, without hope and without God. Yet through Jesus Christ, they were brought near. And the dividing wall had been taken down, with the laws of commandments abolished to make one new family, creating reconciliation and ending the hostility. You know, and in verse 14, you see that it says, the dividing wall has been taken down. And so which wall is Paul really talking about? You know, it may seem that he's talking about that dividing wall that was in the temple, you know, the Sarek. But, you know, that dividing wall, that physical dividing wall that separated the two groups was just symbolic of the hostility that existed between the Jew and the Gentile nations. So, you know, Paul is actually talking something more spiritual, that division of the heart, you know. And just a side point, you know, it's important for us to note that, you know, in that culture of the day, the wall of division wasn't just between, you know, Jews and Gentiles. You know, even within the Jewish community itself, you know, there's a whole hierarchy of, you know, as we know, the Pharisees thought they were better than the regular people. And then there was male and female, you know, women were not considered, and there's rich and poor. So there's all these divisions. You know, human beings have a way of just having divisions. Any little thing where we're different, we can throw up a wall of division, a hostile division, you know. But in Jesus, you see, Jesus Christ, who is our peace, he tore down the wall, he tore them down. Because, you see, he came to reach all people everywhere. You know, through him we have access in one spirit to the Father. One spirit. Gentile believers are no longer strangers and aliens. But we were united with Jewish believers in Christ. The united family, the church, it is built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets with Jesus as the cornerstone. Everything grows out of him. And it's for him. We're all one in Christ. You know, there's another scripture in Galatians 3:28. It says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, slave nor free. We're all one. And how did Jesus achieve this peace? You see, he achieved peace. You know, it says he achieved the peace in his flesh by his death on the cross. He set aside, or he made null and void, the law, and he killed the hostility. You know, and as I was reading this passage, you know, that Jesus is dead is what's going to bring peace. You know, Jesus' death is the only death that can bring peace. You know, mankind has fought several wars, numerous wars over the centuries, or, you know, millennia. You know, so many lives have been lost because of wars, so many lives. But it has never brought peace. We just live to fight some more wars. But Jesus, and of course we don't see peace in the entirety right now, but his death is what's going to bring peace, a lasting peace, eventually on this earth. So Christ's death broke down the dividing wall between God and people. He made all believers, Jewish believers and Gentile believers, holy and righteous in his presence. He broke down the wall of hostility to form two, in himself into one new humanity, to reconcile both in one body to God. So that's why there is no need for the rules and the regulations that separated the two groups. You see, Jews and Gentiles are now one holy people in Christ, and it is through faith, not through the law. So now we have been called to peace and reconciliation. We have been called to reconciliation to peace, to reconciliation to God, and we have been called to reconciliation to our fellow man. So we are now to be his instruments of peace. But you know, there is a question I have again, another question. As believers and instruments of his peace, is it still possible to harbor resentment and hostility towards others? Do we still throw up dividing walls of hostility to certain groups of people?
Yeah.
Of course we do. You know, and you know, in this fallen world that we live in, it's easy to do. It's easy to do because we are human. And even though Christ has broken down the dividing wall of hostility, we are still people. We are different people. We are people from different walks of life, backgrounds, ethnicities, upbringings. And therefore, it's easy for us to offend and to be offended. We can still harbor hostility because of misunderstanding, as I mentioned earlier, or fear. You know, we fear people who are different from us. We can harbor hostility because of prejudice. You know, but God has called us to love others and to preach a gospel of peace and to live in peace as much as it depends on us. It says so in Romans 12 and verse 18. And so I just want to take a look at some of the walls of hostility that we can build today. And this is not, you know, all, because any little thing, we can build a wall. But some of the walls of hostility we build today, you know, it's the same walls that they built in Jesus' day. You know, it's kind of the thing that people say you should never talk about, and that's race, religion, and politics. You know, those tend to cause so much division, you know. And so let's look at walls of racial and social and economic prejudice. You know, any one of us can be guilty of feeling superior because of our race or our social or economic status. You know, that can be such a major wall, you know. You know, we can think that because we are so educated or so rich, we're better than others. Or because of our ethnicity, we're better than others. You know, but despising someone who is different from us just on the basis of race and ethnicity is sin. Why? Because we are made in the image of God. And so racism is really against God. It's against God. You know, Psalm 139 and verse 13 says, "For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful." You know, so that's how we should see people, as being fearfully and wonderfully made by God. So we have to celebrate our differences. Because being one in Christ does not mean that we are made the same. One doesn't mean same. You know, remember that old song we used to sing, One Faith, One Love? You know, just a verse from that song, it says, our many lives are woven, thickly blended, as tapestry created by thy hand. Within each thread, thy glory is extended, with every color, quality, and strand. Upon thy loom, our differences become one, a pleasing tribute to thee and thy son. So our differences, there are differences, but we are one, and that is pleasing. Our differences becoming one is pleasing. It's a pleasing tribute to God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So racism should never be made among us. And I just want to say that this is not just between black and white. You know, in the U.S., we always tend to think that the prejudice is just between these two groups. But it can be between any two groups, any number of groups. It can even be between people of the same ethnicity, you know, when you're despised because you may be lighter or darker or your hair curlier or straighter than others in your own race. So you can have racism even within your own race. But we're all made in the image of God. We are fearfully and wonderfully made, each one of us. And the other part, you know, we talked about is showing partiality because of social and economic status, you know. You know, we may think, oh, I'm so rich, or oh, I'm so educated, but, and we show favoritism to those who we think are, you know, up here. You know, but James 2 says, my brothers and sisters, believers in the glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing the fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit on the floor at my feet, have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? But if you show favoritism, you sin and you're convicted by the law as lawbreakers. You see, it doesn't matter what race or social status we are. We're all at the same level at the foot of the cross. You see, because if we're rich, Jesus is wealthier than all of us. If we think we know so much, God is all-knowing. You see, we're all sinners and need a Savior. We were all once enemies who are brought near to God by the blood of Jesus. So sometimes we do have to sort of examine ourselves because we may think we love all people until a particular situation arises and then we realize the deep-seated prejudices, you know. This happened to the Apostle Peter. You know, if you remember in Galatians 2:11, you know, Paul said he had to confront Peter because when Peter came to Antioch, He used to eat, he said he had to oppose him to his face because he used to eat with the Gentiles. You know, but then, when some friends of James came, Peter wouldn't eat with the Gentiles anymore. Because he was afraid of the criticism from these people who insisted on the necessity of circumcision. So as a result, other Jewish believers followed Peter in his hypocrisy. And even Barnabas, Paul said, was led astray. So here was Peter, the leading disciple in Christ's group. He had to be called out because of his hypocrisy in relation to the Gentiles. So we just have to be careful with that. We just have to make sure that we do truly love all people, you know, regardless of race, ethnicity, social status, economic status. You know, the other area where we can build walls is political. Walls of political divide, if you will. You know, the political divide that we experienced in this country last year was just unprecedented, but at least for this century. Yeah. You know, there were cases where families were not speaking to each other because they had different political views. People on Facebook were going back and forth with each other. It was terrible. You know, people were unfriending each other on Facebook. You know, that's where you use Facebook, you know, you can unfriend a person, you cut them off, you know, so you're not friends with them on Facebook anymore. And mixed up in all of this, but Christians were doing it too. Slinging mud at each other, hurting each other, building up walls of hostility. And this is all over human government. But can we have different political views as Christians? Of course we can. Do we have the freedom to vote for who we want? Yes, of course we do. But having resentment to anyone based on these human governments, to where we throw up these hostile walls, it should not be. We should not, you know, we should keep in mind that we are Christ followers first. We should not let our political identities take precedence over our identity in Christ. You know? Another area, walls of religious pride or self-righteousness. You know, as Christians, you know, God has made us holy. We just heard we are made holy and we are made righteous in Him. But if we are careless, we can become self-righteous. And we can start to build walls between us and non-believers. We start seeing people as them and us. You know, those people in the world, like we live off in, you know, another planet somewhere, you know. So we can build walls when we forget that we were sinners in need of mercy, grace, and peace of God, and that we need salvation, just as anyone else, just as they do. And so we must remember, we must not forget that we once were aliens and strangers who now have been brought near to Jesus. You know, a friend of mine, she works with homeless, and she told me that many times while she's trying to help them, once they learn that she's a Christian, they sometimes become hostile and suspicious of her. And she said this is usually because they had prior encounters with others who call themselves Christians. She says she's not exactly sure what it is they say or do, but somehow they make the homeless feel so invisible and looked down upon that they don't even want to accept, you know, the handouts. But her approach to them is to convince them that she's just there because she knows the love of Jesus and she wants them to know He loves them too. And she says usually with that approach, she gains their trust. Yeah. So what do we do when we find ourselves building walls of hostility instead of being instruments of peace? What do we do? Well, first of all, we must remember that we were once like them. But only by the grace of Jesus, this is no longer true. Remember that at one time, this is the scripture that says, at one time you were separate from Christ, excluded from the citizenship of Israel, and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, who once were far away, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So in other words, we too were sinners in need of forgiveness and in need of salvation. So what do we do when we find ourselves building walls? We remember that we once were sinners needing salvation. Secondly, we come back to the cross. We come back to the cross of Jesus and we repent of that hostile pride. And it is a lot of times pride that makes us build these walls. So we repent of the hostile pride and ask Him to make us instruments of His peace. And thirdly, we focus on Him and we imitate Him. What did He do? He was the wall breaker, the peacemaker. So in conclusion, as I wrap this up, You know, we see that the Berlin Wall and the Sarek are symbols of wall of hostility between people. But as I said in the video this morning, you know, Pastor Tika said, if you're tired of building and tearing down walls of hostility, let us focus on Jesus, who himself is our peace. Jesus is our peace. Let us imitate that. Let us go to him. Let us remember who we are in Christ. So in the midst of this darkened, hostile world, let us be the light of Jesus and the instruments of his peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.